Okay, let's go. Hello, everybody. I'm Hunter O'Haney, and I'm the director of the Stonewall National Museum and Archives here in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And happy Tuesday, everybody. Nice to see you all. I'm here with artist Paul Lee. Hello, Paul. How are you?
Hello. I'm well, thank you.
Where are we finding you this evening?
I'm in NYC.
NYC, yeah. Which of the boroughs are you?
I'm in Manhattan.
Manhattan, nice. Yeah. And so what part of Manhattan? Now I'm getting jealous.
I'm near Union Square.
Yes, I used to live at 2nd Avenue and 21st Street, so I know Union Square very well. Well, we're going to be talking with Paul for the next hour, and this is part of a continued series of virtual online events that we've been doing ever since COVID-19 broke out. And I've been talking about the disease and the pandemic a lot for the last 5 months or 6 months. And it's nice to say, at least right now today, that the number of new cases in the United States and the number of deaths have been going down, but it's still a context in which most of the United States is aware of. And then also to add another degree of complexity, we are 3 weeks away from a presidential election right now. And also the Supreme Court, I'm sorry, the U.S. Senate is having hearings right now for a new ninth member of the Supreme Court. So the context that we are talking is a context in which there's a lot of change. Society has been changed in many ways. Norms have been sort of thrown down and they have been recast. And so it's in that context that we're going to have our conversation. So for those of you who don't know about Stonewall, we are one of the largest LGBTQ libraries and archives in the United States. We have over 28,000 books in our library, and the archives have 2,700 linear feet, which translates to slightly over 6 million pages of material. As they say, that's a lot of gay stuff, and we do have a lot of it. A lot of it are serials and periodicals, primarily from the last quarter of the 20th century to the present day, but also there's a lot of stuff from the 1950s to the present day as well. And so if you are in South Florida, please come and visit. If you're a researcher, artist, scholar, please come, because there's plenty of material there for you to interpret in your work. And just one last thing, on Thursday night this week, we're having our first virtual fundraiser. It will be at 7 p.m. You can find all the details. Tickets are super cheap, $35 a piece. You can find all the information at stonewall-museum.org. Starts at 7 p.m. East Coast time. I understand there are quite a few people who are signed up for it. And there'll be performances by a Broadway singing sensation, Sean McDermott, as well as comic Judy Gold. She has a new book out, and so she will be entertaining us as well. So also for tonight, Paul's gonna be sharing some slides and a bit video and showing us some of his work. If you have questions, please throw them into the chat section. We'll be monitoring that, or the Q&A, you can put them in there. We'll try to keep most of the questions to the last 15 minutes of the talk, but please feel free to put stuff there. Often we'll look at these things and we'll say that's something we want to address at the given time, so don't be shy. And just want to do one last shout out to Emery Grant. Behind the scenes is Emery Grant. Hello, Emery, reveal yourself. Thank you, nice to see you. Emery is our deputy director at Stonewall, and he's one who has all those giant levers. He's trying to make work behind the scenes there. So I think that's all the bit business I have. I'm sure I've probably forgotten something. So Paul, tell me, how have you been faring during COVID?
I've been well. I've been spending all my time at my studio, which is kind of what I do anyway. At first, I wasn't leaving the apartment, but as the quarantine got less severe and it was okay to use the subway, before that I was riding on a bicycle, but then we were allowed to use the subway because at first it was just for emergency workers, and so it didn't seem like it was the right thing to do. But now I'm just going to the studio all the time, so which is what I would do before COVID.
So for, So for those of you who don't know Paul, Paul was born in 1974 from London. You might be able to detect that from his accent, but he lives and works in New York. How long have you been in New York?
Since 2001.
Great, 2001, great. Almost 20 years, isn't that amazing? Yeah. Paul has his BFA from the Winchester School of Art in Winchester in UK, Central St. Martin's University of the Arts in London as well. And he considers himself to be a New York-based sculptor, collagist, video artist who crafts assemblage from used domestic and everyday objects. And what Paul has been able to do with his work is actually transform familial objects into colorful abstractions. So you can read Paul's full bio. Is it paullee.com?
Well, I have a gallery in London that's called Stuart Shave Modern Art, and they have my information there. And also in New York, I have a gallery called Karma Gallery, and they also have information on their website and images. I don't actually have my own website at this time.
All right. So, Paul, let's talk a little bit about your work. So let's imagine it's the first time I've seen your work. And that's not true. I've seen it. I've been watching it for a while. What would you want me to know about your work? Or how would you characterize your work?
Oh, well, it's sort of, I don't know how I would characterize it. It's a sort of an abstract kind of it's sort of abstraction that is trying to sort of grip onto kind of emotion or have a conversation with feel. That's a very broad question. It's kind of hard to answer that. I think the best way I could probably do it is by talking through the work and showing you images, because it's a visual practice. But I think I would say that it comes from it's an act of expression, but it also engages in the idea of, with the ideas of trying to express at the same time. So it's kind of sort of, it's like a compromised expression, but it embraces the expression. It embraces that into it. And I would say that that's kind of an important thing about it. There's kind of, it wants to sort of, there's a lot of references to water in the work, like the soda cans and towels and a lot of different things I do. And I think that that speaks about this idea of information sort of flowing. But I think that feelings are, when a sort of faced, if you know, faced with oppressive idea, environment, or sort of questioning one's, the natural kind of instincts of desire or whatever, they come from that space where that is drawn into, you know, they come from that space where desire is not allowed to sort of be, but yet they celebrate. They're celebratory. They're an acknowledgement of the past, and they look to the future.
This is a very articulate way of understanding it. And so having seen your work a lot, it's so wonderful to hear you describe it this way. And because it really reflects how I see a lot of your work, but also there's part of the work which might feel unresolved or maybe not fully realized all the time. And I sense that's part of what you're saying here too. And that this is a body of work which is not finished forever, but you know, there's so many loose ends that are being tied together, and so it's interesting in that way. But maybe for us to dig into some of it, I know you prepared some slides, and let's put some work up on the screen here and let people take a look at it.
Okay. Let's get this right. Play. And I have to click share screen. Is that working?
I see your cursor and I see a black screen. Maybe move on to the next slide.
Oops, that's the field. There we go. I think I was in the wrong spot there. Excuse me.
Here we go. Oh, here we go.
And then play. Okay, is that working?
Yep.
All right. And is it just a blank screen around it?
Yes.
Okay.
Blank screen around, and it's a black and white photograph of your sculpture there.
Okay, so we're on. It's working. Well, this sculpture was, I think, one of the most important sculptures for me from my first show in New York. I've been making little collages where I wrapped an image around a drinking straw. And I was able to sort of expand on that by wrapping the image around a soda can. And I think I was thinking about photographs and trying to get to a space where the photographs or the images had an internal space where, so that there could be a dialogue with an image or something. And this one, I think, is sort of a key one for me because the eyes are a soda can, but yet it seems to be looking at, the sculpture's almost looking at itself and it's looking at the crushed can. So there's this kind of internal dialogue that's set up with the young man's, the image with the, between the photo and the sculpture, you know, like, and it's looking at itself. And I don't know, this seemed like it was a, and then that's also reflected in the image of the hand that's holding the can, that's also a crushed can. So I was thinking, and the black and white refers back to the image, how it's black and white. So the white can is crushed, and that represents the sort of the light space in the photograph, and the black can represents the dark space in the photograph. And this also has a washcloth in it that's folded, and that represents the sort of dark space too. And sort of it's trying to sort of almost like open up a photograph and open it up to become a place for feelings. And I think that that sort of ties to this idea of like image and it's like image and mind, and then object and body. So it's like bringing those two things together, like bringing the sort of the desire, like trying to create a real space for desire, like linking the body with the fantasy, the image with the object. It's that's the sort of space in which the language is evolving, I think. It's and trying to sort of find a truth in desire or something.
And is it fair to say that some of the imagery and materials that you're using, for example, the towel, might be a reference back to gay male bathhouses or other sources like that, or the way a towel might touch our naked body, or that maybe the face might be something out of gay male pornography, or even the gesture in the hand. It seems to me from what I've read that there, that the work is coded, and not coded that strongly, but it's imbued, is probably a better word, with a lot of these gay references.
Yeah, that, I mean, that's something that speaks to me because I was really sort of, when I first came to New York, for instance, I sort of landed in this space where I met people that had lived through the AIDS crisis, and I met all these amazing gay artists that somehow kind of were making it work as artists and living their lives and expressing themselves and identity was a big part of the art world at that time, sort of identity politics, and or the 90s where it was more so, but you know, it was continuing on into the new the 2000s or whatever. And I don't know, I was thinking about all these things. I was sort of trying to sort of understand and learn about art history, or gay art history, you know, and being excited, like, oh, Jasper Johns was gay, or Rauschenberg was gay, what an exciting story, and they were lovers. And but then also something like the washcloth, I was thinking of it as a photograph, and like, how is a towel like a photograph or a recording of a process of time? So there were a lot of different things that, also, there's this idea, there's this thing about utilitarian objects like a soda can or a washcloth or a light bulb, or they were things that were sort of, they're always slightly different at home in England, you know, utilitarian objects there, that everything's just slightly different or something. So there was, I don't know, I was sort of drawn to the difference of them or something. And in much the same way as like early on, I was making collages out of FedEx envelopes and things like that, because I would see them all around and they gave me this sort of sense of, I don't know, sort of like, I just left England. I left home, and I was like trying to sort of be sort of an out proud young person. And I don't know, I think I was just trying to sort of, I don't know, I'm going off track a little bit, but.
Let's take a look at some of the other images.
Yes. So this was a, in retrospect, a kind of overcrowded installation of my first New York show at Massimo Ordiello Gallery. And there's already here like your towels and soda cans. And that work I just showed was just over here behind this wall. But that was one of the pieces in that show. And I was sort of just exploring the materials, and here this blue piece, washcloth sort of stacked piece in the back. I was thinking about the idea of the washcloth getting progressively dirtier as it was used. But then I was bringing them together. So I was like opening up that space of time and trying to create an open space of time, like open up time or desire into time. And that's, you know, that was kind of what I was thinking about. And I think that was when I started to really think about the idea of the black towel, and the black towel became really important because it was a manifestation of time, but it also in its kind of void quality represented space. And I think that those two things of time and space, the kind of coming together in that object, it really became sort of an important part of my language that I was developing. So,
great.
So these were some washcloth works that were in the office at that show. I'd made so much work for the exhibition, and so we hung these up in the office. But these are washcloths and dyed with ink, and sewn together in different ways to create mostly kind of things that I was thinking about as landscapes. Mm. So I was really thinking about the washcloth as a landscape, and if it was green, it was like grass, or, you know, if it was pink, it was like skin, and then I was thinking of red as kind of like red light, and then, you know, if you add water to red, you get pink, and all these different sort of things, really, of just thinking about the materials and how they relate to the materials themselves can actually become pictures of the spaces in which they come from or something.
And these pieces are sewn, you said, right?
Yeah, they're sewn together and then they hang on little metal hoops.
And when you were a kid, did people in your family, when you grew up in London, were there people around you that sewed?
My mum would sew. She had a Singer sewing machine, and she would sew turning up trousers and for school and things like that. She wasn't making things really, but she would always do the kind of adjustments on the school uniforms and things like that.
And was that something that interested you at the time?
I think so. I mean, I think it's kind of like sewing machines are like amazing. And I think that I was kind of, I think I was kind of fascinated by my mum doing that actually. Like it was, I don't even know if I knew it. Like I can say looking back on it, there's something sort of romantic about that. And I don't think that it was more sort of like a fascination. Maybe it was like my mum using a machine and like this kind of machine that like connected, that she powered with her foot. The foot pedal was kind of, I remember the foot pedal being kind of interesting. So that's kind of interesting. It's kind of like this foot powered machine that then you sew with. So it sort of engages the kind of whole body.
I find it fascinating that as adults, an artist who end up using this type of craft, I find in many cases, there's usually something in which there was a positive experience. It's not all in all cases, but even if they didn't participate as a kid, there was something that was, I don't know, reassuring or nice for them. So let's go on to the next one.
So there weren't any tambourines in my first show, but in New York. But then I started making tambourine works, and the first ones I made, I was painting rectangles onto, because I was thinking about them as screens, and I was interested in, you know, photography and film obviously and things like that. And then I just sort of wanted to put a screen on this thing that you could, was about touching, that you couldn't touch. I guess that was what it was, you know. And the tambourines sort of became like, I was working with the towels, and I wanted to sort of do something that was kind of more like painting. And I can't remember how that, like, I think I remember seeing a painted tambourine at an antique shop or something, and then, but that wasn't at the time, I think it just entered my subconscious. And then the tambourine became this, you know, the skin of the kind of, from the, it was like a object with skin. And I don't know, it made a lot of sense in my, as part of the vocabulary that I was building. And so, yeah, it was really exciting. And I've still, I still work with the tambourine, but it constantly changes. And it's interesting because I think some people, like, have said to me, so, you know, why still the tambourine, you know, why not? You know, why do something different, but something, and I'm doing many different things, but there's something really interesting to me about having this thing that's a core, a central object, but everything around it changes. And I sort of really like that. And I've been working on these new works on paper in my studio, and one series of them is called Tambourine Heart. And I've been thinking about the tambourine as this thing that beats, you know, and the idea of it as a heart, this kind of internal thing. And then I'm working on, they're all kind of red works on paper. And then there's a black body of works on paper that I'm working on that I'm calling Tambourine Moon. So it's, then that's the idea of the tambourine as this kind of external kind of romantic place. I've often thought about the tambourine in relation to the moon as well, actually, in a sort of a poetic way or something.
Nice.
So there'll be a lot of tambourines. So this was a show I did in Berlin, and it was a couple of shows after my show in New York. I did another show in LA, and then I did this show. And these were tau podiums with lights on. I was like interested in the idea of the tau sack and the tau as a container in a different way. I was thinking about the tau as like a photograph, but then I made them into sacks, and it was like another way of containing something. And then on there's a large piece on the wall, and it's a towel. I've made a towel sack, and then I tore into it. And I was thinking about these kind of gendered colors, like pink and purple and blue. and how the blue was like the boys and the pink was like girls, and then the purple was like this kind of non-gendered in-between color. And so in this sack work, I brought those three kind of gendered colors together, and then I made a big tear in it. So it was almost like all this water could just flow out of it or something together. And like all these things were one thing or something, like, and so that's what I was thinking about with that piece. And then on the back of the wall, there's some can sculptures. And then the piece on the floor with the rocks, because I was thinking about water a lot, and I'd been using pieces of coal in some of the can sculptures, which is another story. But the rocks, I was just thinking about water, and this is a spilled rock sack. And it was this idea that the water would flow through the rocks, you know, as the rocks, as the blue towel sack was spilled. So it's like, there's a lot of absence in the work and suggested things that aren't really there. And I think that that's another way of opening a kind of a window or a path to.
This is an absolutely beautiful image with the rocks and the sack here. Really, it's just a lovely image. Are those rocks, or are those sculptures?
No, it's they're cast in plaster from a rock. Actually, I knew I needed a rock, and I was in Provincetown with some friends cycling from the beach along the towards the breakwater there, and. There were a lot of rocks, and I was like, one of these has to work. And so it's actually a rock from Provincetown, which is a really nice thing to me, because, you know, Provincetown was so important to me. That was where I first exhibited, and I took a box of cardboard box of work to Michael Carroll, actually.
Michael Carroll at the Schoolhouse Gallery, yes.
Yeah. And so it was really nice to have that in this rock, and then to cast it over and over again, because I felt like going to Provincetown and spending a couple of summers there and was where I really just sort of became sort of like a complete, a more complete kind of gay person in a way. Like, I learned so much and I met so many amazing people, and I met drag queens, and I don't know, it was just, so anyway, that's, it's really nice to have a rock in there from Provincetown. This is a work made from, there was a work like this in that last show, but this is three towels, the edges of towels that I dyed blue and sewed them together. And it was, the blue towel is interesting to me because it's water and sky. And water and sky really talk about the kind of the process of the towel. It absorbs the water, but then it kind of releases it into the air. So in a way, this work kind of opens up the idea of the towel, and talking about function in that way, which function is a really kind of interesting thing to me, because I've said this before, but it's like in a way that it speaks to truth. So opening up the function of this object in a way was kind of what I was thinking about with this piece. So I've made different kinds of works like this with the towels, with the centers cut out. And really it is to open up that towel, and makes it into kind of a screen or a pathway or an open space, you know, where things can be projected onto. And so that's what I was thinking about with these kinds of works.
And it's such a lovely piece because, I mean, you have really sort of taken a negative space and turned it so positive, which is a very nice idea. So thank you.
Well, I was calling these pieces negatives at the time because I was interested in how, you know, because I'd been thinking about photography a lot, and so it just sort of made sense that I was thinking of them as almost like strips of film that could be processed to make images.
Sure.
So this is another tambourine work. I started to sort of build on top of them. And this was around, let me see if I can look at my, around 2014 or so. And I was sort of taking the sort of shape of the square that would cover the tambourine. And then that's where that form comes from. And then I was flipping it on its side and then opening it up. And this is really kind of like, I think it's sort of sunlight and moonlight kind of colliding in a way. But it also, a lot of these works, these ones, I did some earlier ones than this, but these ones very much were almost, you could hold on to them. It was like a different way of holding on to the object or something. So in a night, it's just an extension and an expansion of thinking about the tambourine and that works. And here's another one. This was in the same show at Rosenwald Wolf Gallery in Philadelphia, which was a show I did of these tambourine works, and then it was mostly these works. I showed some at the Independent in New York as well, just before this. So, this is another can sculpture, and I was thinking about the kind of, the red light was sort of interesting, how it kind of related to sort of processing photographs, but it's also how it's sort of this idea of the kind of red light and the sexual thing of it. And so I was developing that idea, and then the string was sort of the idea of sort of a cord that you could pull that was like a light switch in a way. And some of these later cans, I've been working with a sort of painted self-portrait, which is on the can in the back. It's printed onto canvas. And I've also started to put blush on the cheeks of the cans, but the paint, I'm sort of thinking about that space between painting and photography, and opening up that space and exploring that space with these works, where the painted self is in the sculpture with the photograph, the photographic image of the kind of the face that I've been working with for 20 years or something, you know.
Well,
almost. So, and I don't know who that person is, you know. I found, you were talking earlier, but I found that image in a kind of a magazine that from the 50s, you know, that was like of an erotic magazine for men, of, you know. So, and I've also used there was a guy on the page next to him, and they were just sort of sitting portraits where they were naked, but I've used images of the guy on the page next to him as well. And I've actually used those images in the same sculpture of the two different faces. So in a way it was like bringing them together in the sculpture. So this is another one, and scale is really interesting to me. I was using the light bulbs and how they relate to they're the similar scale to the can and the magnifying glass. And there's a piece of coal in this one too. And it's what you were asking me about my mum. It's like with the sewing machine, like we used to have in the 80s, there was all this big stuff in England. I remember when I was a kid where the coal miners were on strike, but we also had a coal cupboard in our base, in our cellar at home, where there was a manhole above it and the coal would get thrown down and there was a closet. It was never used when I was a kid, but it was out of date at that point. But there was some coal down there, and it was this fascinating object to me. And so I kind of really was into, like, it was interesting to me how it kind of relates to the black towel in a way. How it represents sort of light and energy, but it's also darkness as matter, you know? So, and my dad had it in the cellar, all these tools and everything, and he would fix umbrellas and stuff down there, and that's where he would like make stuff. And that also fascinated me, you know, like he was very much sort of like able to fix everything and all that sort of stuff. So the coal was like this kind of interesting kind of, had this kind of weird personal connection as well. So, but the coal is where the rocks sort of came from, the coal as well as from the water. So it's like this language that's evolving and developing, but it's also, I don't know, it's like overlapping and it, within the different material, like it overlaps in different ways or something. So I guess this is earlier than the ones with the objects on, actually. And it's another tambourine. I was just thinking about that kind of space, kind of compressing, and a different way of thinking about moving towards an object or touching or opening up that space of touch into a sculptural space. So, so this is an installation of a show at Macaron Gallery, which was my second show in New York. And these were two videos I made. One was I cut up a towel and I sewed it into a piece of film. And this show was in, I don't know. Actually, my dates aren't very good here. My calendar's not helping me. Like maybe 2010. Mm-hmm. And so one's shower curtain sewn into film and the other one is towel sewn into a film. And for both of them, I ran them over a light box and then I filmed it and then I showed it on the wall. And I think with the towel, it was like, it was five different colored towels. And in a way it was like opening up that towel. And it was like, it looked like it was like raining light. And it was this kind of like different way of like thinking about the towel and about the process of the drying, but putting that into the abstract space of color and sort of looking, searching for this kind of like, I think purity within color, or this idea of color as this kind of pure space. And then the film of the shower curtain, which came from the idea of the film of the towel, which it sort of, the shower curtain itself became like, it looked like it was running, it was water falling. So the object, in a way, represented the process that went on behind it. So it's thinking about like screens in these different ways and about kind of, I don't want to say dislocating because that sounds like a negative thing, but maybe relocating desire, like relocating desire in this kind of abstracted kind of pure or new space that comes from the kind of the process of making these abstract objects, you know, abstracting desire in a way. And sculpture is like an abstracted body in a way, you know, or all art is a way of like, trying to sort of understand, like, I don't know, existence or humanity or feeling and being. And so this piece is made of washcloths, and it was a piece in a group show in LA. This is kind of a bit later than the other ones, but again, it talks about the process of water and climbing and then gridding and then flowing, but it was all like it's sort of an opened up grid, and it talks about the different ways of like water flowing, or it speaks to the material that it's made out of. So this is a slightly earlier piece actually from the show in London. And I was thinking about, I wanted to sort of, where the pieces overlapped, I kind of wanted to sort of, I don't know, it was thinking about this kind of idea of the overlapping of the washcloths and sort of playing with that density or the space in a way of expanding space or something. And I think it was called Turn Time Inside Out, this piece actually. So, and this is from the same show. This, the taller work, the work that's not the stairs, was this idea that you could flip it and it would spin or something, and it would sort of create kind of time in the present. It was like a little axis. I've made a lot of things that sort of are about an axis and how a flat thing can then rotate and become a three-dimensional thing. And there's a Rauschenberg piece actually that I've always liked, that it's a little closet and it has a bicycle wheel in it. And I think the idea is that you sit on the chair in the closet and then you can spin the bicycle wheel. And I guess that that's his like closet piece or something, you know, but I think I've always been fascinated by that piece and the idea of the closet. And I don't know, it's a nice Rauschenberg sort of work. And I think that I was thinking about that piece a bit, although stylistically they're very different in that work. And it's made out of four towels sewn together and then cut into. And then this is a washcloth at the top of a stairs that is made from hand towels. And it's called, the material there was very important because I was thinking about the hand towel as specific to the hands, but I wanted to make something that you put your feet on and went upstairs. So it talked about the whole body in a way that kind of ties back to what you brought up earlier about the idea of the foot pedal and my mum's sewing machine. It's like the object, I don't know, the foot and the hand, and bringing the foot and the hand together to get to the washcloth or the dark box that's at the top of the stair in a way. And then I was sort of trying to explore the kind of texture of the skin of the tambourine on some works and thinking about kind of opening up layers and the fictional skin and the real skin of the tambourine. And so it's kind of a different way of thinking about the surface of the paintings, actually. So always exploring.
That's absolutely gorgeous. I mean, these are two, but that last piece is just really spectacular.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm excited because I'm going to be working on some paintings in my studio that I'm wanting to expand on, some drawing, some works on paper that I'm going to show you at the end. But I'm excited to sort of explore paint more in the new work in a painterly way. And I think that I was thinking about this very much with that. So these are towel works, and the one on the, I don't know if what your left and right is here, but the one with the little washcloth is called lung, and it's kind of this idea of opening up the space between the washcloth and the towel. The washcloth cleans the body and it's wet, and then the towel is the drying space. And it was creating that drying space into kind of like a rummage space that you could move back through and get to the washcloth at the bottom of the pile sort of thing. So it was creating this kind of imaginary kind of space of movement in a different way to get from one thing to the other. And then some is one towel and some is two towels. And it was this idea of expanding and contracting. And so this piece is called Lung, because I was thinking about the idea of the air and the breath and the lung and how I was kind of thinking about that in a way. And then this other large piece is also made of towels, and it's sort of open again. It's like opening up that kind of process of the drying, like the water's in the towel and then it sort of evaporates into the air. But then I sort of toppled it over. So I was like interrupting that kind of space where something is kind of disappearing out of reach or something. So this is one of the, I started to build on top of the tambourines. And then this is the one of the first pieces where I started to bring in canvas with the tambourine. It's actually before that other one, the painterly one earlier. And that little curved line was masked out, and that's still the skin of the tambourine underneath. And so I was starting to explore that idea, and this is the first one in part of a big body of work that I made for that the macaron show that was I just showed you in Los Angeles, that was in Los Angeles. And I made a lot of work for that show. I made like so many paintings.
Mm, wow.
And this is one of the works in that show. And this is another one. And this is one of the ones, it wasn't in that show, but one of the ones I made at that time. I think that their show was in 2016, and it was called Layers for a Brain Corner. And I think I was thinking about this idea of different plateaus. So that's why the three-dimensional aspect was still in these, even though they were kind of paintings, because it was like a step towards something, you know, it's like the step again. And then I started to break them down and take the canvas off and think about the support structure again and try and go inside or whatever. And so I was using glass and it was like a window inside the painting. So it was like another way of trying to move towards something.
And stopping here for a minute. I mean, the juxtaposition of those two images, where one is just so incredibly serene and just, as you have been using the term painterly as well, and then going to the next one, which is really there's so much activity and so much participation in that piece. That's really, it's so beautiful seeing those two next to each other.
Thank you. It's interesting because like I'm working with a lot of things that I'm using scraps of paintings, and so in a way to me they're part of the same process. And it's like interest, like it talks about painting as well, you know. I used a paintbrush and there's bits of the painting, and so as I was bringing in painting into the practice more, or not the practice but like working in the studio more, I started to bring those elements. I sort of went back and how does this change the can sculptures? How can these things speak to each other? You know, and so it's just sort of another way of sort of trying to sort of understand the language or develop it in a way.
Yeah, no, it's, and they just seem so incredibly successful being juxtaposed like this. I really do want to see the video that you have queued up for us. And I think you said the video is 7 minutes. And so I'm just a little bit conscious of time here. Can we skip to the video?
Yeah, I'll go through really quickly and we'll just get okay. to it. I won't say anything.
Well, I mean, they're just so beautiful. Oh. And then of course your use of color is amazing.
Thank you. Well, that's another part of the kind of language as well that I'm interested in.
And of course, we were talking earlier about some other influences, particularly with queer art. I mean, everybody from Ellsworth Kelly to Robert Indiana to Rauschenberg and to Johns and stuff. It's just, I mean, the stuff is so rich in all of it. Not even that the work is referential to them, but it is part of that body or that canon of that gay abstraction, which is really so beautiful.
Well, I do want to speak to that, those people through the work in a way, if I can, you know, like, in a, or like have a conversation with it, you know, art is a dialogue. So, yep.
Oh my God.
This is my last show in Houston, and it's my COVID show, I guess, because it didn't really open, not properly. I wasn't able to go there. And
oh, those are beautiful.
Thank you. I was excited about this.
Amazing.
It's called Divided. And I was just really excited to sort of bring the kind of elements of the red, white. It's kind of like the red, white, and blue sort of thing in a way, but although it's red, white, and purple, or red, white, and black. Mm. And so, and the space in the middle is like this divided kind of architectural work made of the washcloths. So I was thinking this piece, this, and the idea of touching and how that relates to COVID. So there were all these like parallels. that were occurring when I was making this show that kind of happened after the point that really, I'm really glad that I made this show and it was up in this time and that I had this document, because I do think it speaks to the time in an abstract way that is exciting to me. So
Yeah. This
is a work from that. Like purple is a mixture of red and blue, and this is called The Kiss. And which I was thinking that little Brancusi sculpture where the two stone, it's a carving where it's kissing, and it just was making me think of that, but it was like opening that kiss up into this different space. And then, but then I was thinking about the red and the blue and how that like is also like, that's like political colors and like all these things. And like, I don't know, having a gay person run as president, and there's all these things in here that like just seem to add up to me to
sure
embody this sort of moment or something in my work at this point. So, and this one's called Table Like, and it's the same thing as it's the support is the object is the picture. So it's the picture and the support at the same time as a table, and you know, so that's what I was thinking about there. These are some new works on paper I'm working on, where I'm taking, they're called, I'm sort of thinking about them as tambourine abstractions or whatever. I'm taking apart the paintings and mixing them with the collage elements from the can sculptures, and the circles that are cut out of the paper are drawn around tambourine bells. So it's taking the idea of the tambourine and it's abstracting it in a way. And this is like new work I'm working on. So I've got three of those I can show you.
Yeah, and sort of the disassembly is sort of interesting in those as well. The fractionalization is sort of really nice compared to some of the others, in the sense that there's a sereneness in some of the others that here you've upset that plane.
Yeah, my friend Ellen actually was at my studio, and she mentioned this, said the idea of regeneration was a big part of my work, and that sometimes we're in different times. They're like, and we're in a time of, at this time, we're in a time of regeneration. And she said that she thought that related to my work in a way, and I thought that was interesting. I don't know. So that's the bells and the tambourine.
Yep.
Deconstructed. And then this is the video.
Let's take a peek.
Okay, so will our little images appear at the side here? Can I move them? Do they go away? Okay.
No, you should be good though.
Paul, the images won't show up in the recording or anything.
Okay.
Will disappear.
Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
Okay. I think you don't have sound.
I said, well, hello.
Hello.
That was an amazing, amazing piece.
Oh, thank you.
When did you make that piece?
It's from, I think it's like 2007. I'm looking at the dates of my shows and trying to figure it out. Between 2007 and 2008, I think.
Yeah.
Maybe it's from 2008.
Wow. So, incredibly powerful. There's so much going on in there. I mean, it's just, art historians are going to write about that piece. They're going to do their dissertation about that piece 100 years from now. And so it's really just incredibly powerful.
Thanks. I was worried that it's kind of, it goes on a little bit in some parts or something.
So many references. Oh my goodness, there's so much that's going on there. Well, Paul, unfortunately, our time has come to an end. I hate to say that, but we're at 7:31, and so we have to end. But this has been just an incredible experience to see your work. I want to thank you so much for sharing your work. So you're working very busily in the studio right now.
Yes, I am. I mean, I always am. I have a good sort of work ethic, and
Are you working toward a particular exhibition now or a particular project?
I have an exhibition in Portland at Amy Adams, Adams and Ullman Gallery in April, I think. And but I'm just working on sort of particular bodies of work at the moment, and hopefully different things will come up and stuff like that. So
sure. Well, I want to thank everybody for joining us. Our guest tonight has been Paul Lee, who's shared some amazing work, an incredible breadth of work that we've seen tonight, from painting to sculpture to video and photography. And so it's been just wonderful. I'm Hunter Ohanian, the director of the Stonewall National Museum and Archives here in Fort Lauderdale. If you don't get a regular newsletter, please come to our website, stonewall-museum.org, and sign up. And also this Thursday night, we have our fall fundraiser, and so you can sign up for that as well. We'll be back next week with another talk. And remember also that this talk tonight has been recorded and it will be posted on our website. Also it will be available for people on Instagram. I just want to say another shout out again to Emery Grant. Emery, I know you're back there pushing all those big levers. Hello there. And so thank you again for all of this. And Paul, thank you again. It was so great. I feel like I want to work with you and your work again. I want to figure out a longer period of time that we can have a conversation about this work, because there's so many layers and there's so many things that are going on there. And this is really the first time, as much as I've known about your work, it's the first time I've actually sort of seen it up close like this and hear you speak about it and hear all the different layers. And so I hope we get to work together again.
I hope so too. Thank you. It's a real honor to do this for the institution, for the museum. So thank you for asking me.
Yes, thank you. All right, good night, everybody. We're 2 minutes over late. One last thing, don't forget to vote. Election's coming up in 3 weeks. So adios, bye everyone.